This is my lecture number 18, and we will talk today about design of an output feedback discrete time control system. I will give you an example, kind of generic example, because I heard from Min that you want to have more examples. This is not a state variable control. It is the output feedback system. Let me start from the transfer function of the controlled process that you can see right here. It is a continuous time controlled process. You should expect that controlled processes will be continuous time processes. And the transfer function GP, P stands for plant or process, that I chose, is a fourth order transfer function. Again, it is assumed that there is no right-hand side zeros in this transfer function. And therefore, when it will be time to cancel zeros, we will have no problem canceling zeros. The next is design specifications that are given. We have the settling time, T settling. We have the percent overshoot. And we have steady state error for a unit step disturbance. And also we have the time step of the discrete time controller, delta T. Design step number one is designing or definition of the desired S-domain closed-loop system transfer function, G-closed-loop. We define transfer function in the S-domain because we know how to do it based on the overshoot and settling time. What we actually do, you do know, we have to specify dominant poles in the S domain and then non-dominant poles. Now, the definition of dominant poles and non-dominant poles in S domain you understand, so it's not a big deal to specify these poles. I want to remind you that there is additional condition. If I would replace S in the definition of this transfer function by zero, I'm supposed to get one. What is the special? What is special about this requirement? The special is this. The steady state response of a system, in this case, to a unit step input will be equal to one. And if you would specify in a system like this, let's say it's a cruise control, 55 miles per hour, if this condition is met, then the system will undergo some transient process and will reach the steady state value of 55 miles per hour. So this is the transfer function. And I use letters for coefficients of the polynomial denominator, the transfer function of the desired closed-loop system. And you can realize that this Q0, zero-order term in the denominator, should be also placed as a constant gain in the numerator. In this case, if I will make S equal to zero, all terms of the denominator will turn into zeros, except Q0, and the numerator will be also Q0. Design step number two is we have to use the computer tool to convert the S-domain transfer function of the controlled process into the Z-domain transfer function, assuming zero order hold. Assuming that zero order hold will be used to drive the process. And we have to specify the time step of the discrete time controller. So this is the symbolism that I like. We will take GP, transfer function of the plant, as a function of S, and we will convert it into GP, but it will be function of Z, and the conversion will utilize zero order fold option and the required time step delta T. And this is the result that we will get. And I can tell you that the numerator, polynomial numerator, will be NP, and polynomial denominator GP of Z. And I chose this Greek lattice to remind you that we're dealing with the Z domain. Design step number three is the conversion of the desired S-domain closed-loop system transfer function into the Z-domain, again using the zero-order hold option and the specified time step of the discrete time controller. So I'm taking the transfer function G closed-loop of S, and I convert it into G closed-loop of Z, and I'm using the zero-order hold option and the time step delta T. Of course, this type of conversion shall be performed using a computer tool. So this is the resultant closed-loop transfer function in the Z domain. And this is the definition of this transfer function. I have polynomial numerator and polynomial denominator. I want you to note that although in the original S domain transfer function I did not have zeros, in the Z domain transfer function I do have zeros. Why it happens? It happens because of the nature of the numerical conversion procedure. So this is what will happen. Design step number four is the definition of the polynomial numerator of the controller. Controller transfer function I will call H of Z, and this is only the numerator. Hn of Z, n stands for the numerator. The order of this polynomial is equal to the order of the controlled process, minus 1. And because of this, H numerator of Z will be a third order polynomial. I have H3Z cubed plus H2Z squared plus H1Z plus H0. Design step number two is this. According to the nature of our design procedure, and it comes from the definition of the closed-loop system transfer function of the system, we will have the following equation. We will have to satisfy this equation. The denominator of the plant plus polynomial numerator of the controller must be equal to the denominator of the closed-loop system, denominator of the desired closed-loop system. The denominator of the plant, polynomial, has been established. The denominator of the closed-loop system has been established. Hn, the polynomial numerator of the controller. We have only configuration for it. It's a third order polynomial. And from this equation, we will find Hn of Z. Let me rewrite this expression. This obviously is the denominator of the control plant. This is still unknown numerator of the controller, and they should be equal to the known, already defined denominator of the closed loop system. If you would do some algebra, you will end up with expression like this. And this enables us to determine H3, H2, H1, and H0. Where this material is coming from? It is coming from our design procedure. And the design procedure was explained to you more than once. Okay? The same explanation you will find in the continuous time control. You know, the process requires to first cancel zeros of the plant, then introduce polynomial feedback, then determine the closed loop system, then make sure that the denominator of the resultant closed loop system will be equal to the denominator of the obtained closed loop system. And this is where you're getting this equation. One way or another, the next design step is the definition of the polynomial denominator of the controller. It is equal to the polynomial numerator of the controlled process. It happens because we engage in two cancellation of zeros of the controlled plant. So, for the feedback controller, the numerator has been established at the step number 5, and the denominator is exactly the same as the numerator of the control plant. The feedback controller has been established. Technically, I have the transfer function of the control plant, and I have the transfer function of the feedback controller, and I have this equation that will be satisfied by the choice of H3, H2, H1, and H0. If I would get for you the closed loop system transfer function, then you will realize that the only way to make this transfer function equal to the desired closed loop transfer function would be to add this control, filter in the reference channel. This filter is defined as follows. The numerator of this filter transfer function is the numerator of the desired closed loop system, and the denominator of this filter is exactly equal to the numerator of the controller. Our design is done. And now I want to make sure that the resultant system transfer function will be equal exactly to the desired transfer function, closed loop transfer function. So let's say that we have the transfer function of the system defined as filter times the transfer function of the controlled plant with feedback H of Z. And then I define explicitly the transfer function of the filter F of Z, it is right here, the transfer function of the controlled plant. In the denominator I have 1 plus the transfer function of the controlled plant times the transfer function of the feedback controller. And then I do some cancellations. I obviously can cancel this polynomial with this polynomial, and I have divided by 1 and 1 over this expression. Then I can cancel this polynomial, and I can cancel this polynomial, and this is the result that I will have after this cancellation. And then I will simplify the result, this result. Now it will look like this. But don't forget that we invested special effort in making sure that this sum in the denominator is equal exactly to the desired characteristic polynomial of the closed loop system. Now I will use expression for the desired characteristic polynomial, and I use the polynomial that came from the filter transfer function, and you can see I'm getting exactly what my intention was. I'm getting the desired closed loop system transfer function. This is the configuration of the system that we have designed. And I want to tell you that we have a continuous time process. Output is Y, control effort is U. We have discrete time controller that picks up output Y. Output Y is discretized, is applied to the control law, and controller generates variable V. The reference signal is applied to the input of the discrete time filter. Filter creates variable W. We subtract V from W, getting the control effort. This is our system. The system's supposed to work. I want to emphasize that when this design is complete, you have to simulate the system. You have to implement your design in the simulation environment. Only simulation will show you if your design is correct. Now, modern software tools, modern simulation software enables us to utilize in the same setup continuous time system and discrete time components of the system. This is how I recommend you to simulate the system that you have designed. When you simulate the system, it's important to show a system step response to reference that will reveal the overshoot and settling time, and the steady state value of the system step response. It makes sense to investigate the control effort versus time for step. You may also apply disturbance signal directly to the input of the plant and evaluate the error. Initially, you had some specifications for the error. So what you have to do is to determine if error caused by unit step disturbance satisfies the design specs. And if it does not satisfy the design specs, you know what to do. You have to go back to your design. You have to redefine non-dominant poles. And you have to repeat your design. And then I want to discuss with you one additional issue. How to implement discrete time components of the system. You can implement them in the software, and you should be able to write the software in whatever language you use. I want to discuss with you specifically the filter, because discrete time controller will be implemented exactly in the same fashion. Look, this is the transfer function for the filter. The input is reference, the output is variable W. So, Z transform of W divided by the Z transform of reference is equal to this transfer function. In order to implement this component of the system in software, I will start from dividing numerator and denominator by the highest power of Z. So the numerator and the denominator I define divide by Z cubed. So obviously I have Q3 times 1 plus theta 3 times 1 plus theta 2 times z in the power of minus 1 plus theta 1 times z in the power of minus 2, and theta 0 times z in the power of minus 3. And similar operation should be performed in the denominator, division by z cubed, and this is what you will get. The next, what I will do, I will multiply this denominator by w and this numerator by r. And this is the equation that I will get. This equation I can easily convert to the discrete time domain, and it will be called the difference equation. Look, I have w of z times beta 3. When I will convert it to the time domain, discrete time domain, I will have beta 3 times w of k. I have w of z times z in the power of minus 1 times beta 2. When I will convert this into the discrete time domain, it will be beta 2 times wk minus 1. Why k minus 1? Because of the delay theorem. And this is what I have to do for each term of this expression. Finally, let's recall that discrete time filter is responsible for generation of variable w. It's supposed to generate w for k equal to 1, w for k equal to 2, w for k equal to 3, and so on the basis of discrete time values of reference r. So this is the recursive formula. Recursive formula defines w of k as a function of current value of reference, value of reference taken one time step ago, value of reference taken two time steps ago, value of reference taken three time steps ago, value of w taken one time step ago, value of w taken two time steps ago, and value of w taken three time steps ago. You can easily implement this computation in the following simple computer code. I'm not telling it's a Fortran or MATLAB or assembly. It is just a computer code that is understood by everyone. This code will start from setting numerical values for theta 3, theta 2, theta 1, theta 0, beta 3, beta 2, beta 1, and beta 0. They are fixed values, should be specified in the beginning of the code. The next, you have to specify the initial conditions. This is value of reference, three time steps ago, it is zero. Value of reference, two time steps ago. Value of reference, one time step ago. Value of w, three time steps ago. Value of w, two time steps ago. Value of w, one time step ago. Now, this is the beginning of the loop. I will place this label 1 to signify that this is the beginning of the loop. And we will start from receiving numerical value for reference. As soon as you have numerical value for reference, what you have to do is to compute the first value of variable w, and you use this formula. And you can see that in the formula, you utilize your zero initial conditions first time around. And then you have to output whatever the value of w is, because value of w will be used in the summing junction to compute the control effort. When this is done, you have to renew the initial conditions. Now r 3 times steps ago will be equal to r2 times steps ago. And r2 times steps ago will be equal to r1 times step ago. And r1 times step ago will be equal to value of r that was recently received. Very similar, you renew initial conditions for the variable w. Your step is complete. Now you have to check the stop conditions. If you will get 0, you have to stop. If you will get value of 1, you have to go back. And if you have value of 1, if stop conditions do not require you to stop the procedure, go back to label 1. You read the reference. It will be next value of reference. You calculate the next value of variable w, and you proceed this chain of calculations. I hope this will help you to get prepared for the take-home project that will be used in lieu of the final exam. I'm still debating whether I will give you the final exam or will give you one more test before the final exam. All right, we have to proceed with our material. And we will get now into the discrete time state variable description of dynamic systems. This is a discrete time dynamic system, nth order system, and the system has m inputs and m outputs. You can see the state vector of the system. It has n components. And it is defined for time k plus 1 for x1, for x2, xn. This is the fundamental matrix of the system, which is a square n by n matrix. This is the same state vector. However, it is defined However, it is defined for time equal to k. This is matrix B. Matrix B has total of n rows and m columns because the number of control efforts is m. This is the output. It has total of m components, y1, y2, ym. Matrix C, which is m times n times state vector x of k. If we would introduce obvious notations, we will get the same result in a matrix vector form. We have state vector xk plus 1 is equal to A times x of k plus b matrix times u of k. Y of k will be equal to matrix C times x of k. Now, we will concentrate on consideration of a nth order single input, single output system. In other words, we will assume that m is equal to 1, where such state variable description comes from two sources. It could be the decomposition of an S-domain transfer function, or it could be from the set of linear system equations of the underlying physical phenomena. And I would start from the decomposition of a Z-domain transfer function. Assume that we have a Z-domain transfer function of the system. It's a nth-order system. This transfer function is equal to the Z-transform of the output divided by the Z-transform of the input. polynomial numerator, polynomial denominator. Order of the denominator is customarily greater than order of the numerator. In this case, order of the denominator is n, and order of the numerator, n minus 1. Now I can define output y of z from this transfer function. This result is obvious. Now I can introduce variable v of z, kind of intermediate variable. Variable v of z is defined as function of the input u. However, in the appropriate transfer function, I have no zeros at all. The numerator is 1. So this is how variable v of z is defined. It is obvious that if I want to define y using variable v, this is what I have to do. I have to take variable v and multiply it by the missing polynomial numerator of the transfer function. And of course, I can move variable v inside the expression, this expression, and this is the result that I will get. So, again, what is written here? This is the definition of the output variable y of z through the values of the intermediate variable v. And then I will define the variable v through the input u. And of course I have to utilize the expression for the polynomial denominator of the transfer function. So finally, I'm getting for you the definition of variable v through the input u of z. And of course, I can move into the left-hand side z in the power of n times v, and the rest of the expression, I will place to the right-hand side of the equal sign. Now let's recall properties of the Z transform, specifically the advanced theorem of the Z transform, and convert relationship between y of z and variable v into the discrete time domain based on this expression. This is exactly what I have. I have y of k is equal to bn minus 1 times v in the power of k plus n minus 1. V of k plus n minus 1. And then I will have bn minus 2, it's right here, times v of k plus n minus 2 and so on up to v of k. That comes out of this expression, out of this term. And similarly, this part that defines v through the input u, I will convert into the discrete time domain. So I used to have z in the power of n times v of z. Now I have v of k plus n. It's equal to a n minus 1 with minus times z n minus 1 times v. Now it is a n minus 1 with minus times v of k plus n minus 1 and so on. Now it is time for me to introduce state variables. I will say that x1 of k is equal to v of k. X2 of k is equal to v of k plus 1 or x1 k plus 1. X3 will be equal to v of k plus 2 or x2 of k plus 1. And finally, I will have x of k defined as v of k plus n minus 1, which is the same as xn minus 1 of k plus 1. Something similar we have done when we introduce state variable description in a continuous system, except instead of time advances, we use derivatives. All state variables have been defined, and now I will rewrite definitions of state variables using the special format that we utilize for establishing state variable description of the system. I will have x1 of k plus 1 equal to x2. I will have x2 of k plus 1 equal to x3. I will have x3k plus 1 equal to x4, and so on up to xn minus 1 of k plus 1 is equal to xn of k. But the next I have to add the xn of k plus 1. This is what I have to add. But from what we have done earlier, xn for k plus 1 is equal to variable v for k plus 1. For k plus 1. An expression for v of k plus 1 we already have established. It's exactly this. It is exactly this. All right? So, this gives me very straightforward definition for the last state variable xn for k plus 1. It's equal to a0 times x1 of k with minus a1 times x2 of k and so on plus u of k. And now we can summarize definition of state variables in a matrix vector form. We have xk plus 1 is equal to a times x of k plus b times u of k. You should be familiar with this configuration of matrix A. It is typical for canonical controllable form. What we actually have done, we performed the direct decomposition of the system transfer function. You want to take a look at the matrix C. Matrix C is shown right here. It consists of elements or coefficients of the polynomial numerator of the transfer function listed in the inverse order, but with the same signs that they have in the polynomial. Yeah, it is a canonical controllable form. And exactly like we have done it in the continuous time case, we should do it by inspection. We don't need any computer tools for doing it. We can define the state variable definition in the CCF by inspection of the transfer function of the system. So look, this is my example. I have this transfer function. This transfer function has this numerator and this denominator. First of all, you should realize it's a fifth order system. Therefore, fundamental matrix is 5 by 5. First four rows are very straightforward and very easy to define, but the last row will have element of z in the power of 0 from the denominator with plus. It is right here. The next element is element of or coefficient of z in the power of 1 from the denominator with minus. Coefficient of z squared from the denominator with plus, and so on. Now, when it comes to matrix B is very easy, all zeros and one, and matrix C has coefficients of the polynomial numerator listed in the inverse order without changing signs. So the first one is plus 41.905, the next is minus 2.65, and so on. I want to remind you that any decomposition of the transfer function results in a state variable definition that effectively are not real variables. They are mathematical fiction. It could be a state variable that is equal to a voltage times some coefficient plus current times some coefficient plus acceleration times some coefficient and so on. So we're getting linear combinations of real physical variables. Obviously, this type of state variables do not exist in nature. You cannot monitor them. However, we use them because of the convenient configurations of the state variable matrices that we use for state variable definition, especially the canonical controllable form that enables us to perform very sophisticated design procedures. Now, there is another way to obtain state variable description of a system. It is based on the equations of physics. We have to consider a system of linear equations of physics describing the physical phenomena behind the operation of the control plant. So this is what I want to do. I am assuming that this is a traditional state variable description of a continuous time controlled process or dynamic system. The state equation and the output equation. In the state equation, you can see the fundamental matrix and the input signal. In the output equation, you see the output variable defined through the state vector and matrix C. First of all, I want to take Laplace transform of this expression, and you know how to do it. The properties of Laplace transform should be utilized. The initial conditions shall not be neglected, and this is what we get. If we would take Laplace transform of this state equation and rearrange some terms, we would get x of s equal to si minus a in the power of minus 1 times state vector of initial conditions plus si minus a in the power of minus 1 times b times u of s. And then you realize that this part represents the natural motion in the system, and this part represents the forced motion in the system. What if I want to get x of t? You have to take the inverse Laplace transform of this expression. So I will take Laplace minus 1 of si minus a times x of t0. And I have to take inverse Laplace transform of si minus a times b times u of s. Now, the first expression is all right. Look, this part is fine. You know that this is the state transition matrix that you are so much familiar with. This expression, this inverse Laplace transform, is troublesome. This inverse Laplace transform is a convolution integral. And because of the convolution integral, the entire expression is unusable, too complex for its own good. However, if we would assume that the distance time interval between t and t0 is equal to capital T, the time step of the discretization of the discrete time procedure. Then, continuous time will be defined as t equal to kt where k is equal to 1, 2, 3, the time will turn into a sequence of discrete moments of time separated by time step capital T. Now, the second assumption should be that we're dealing with a staircase signal. U of t is not a continuously changing signal, it's a staircase time signal. What is special about the staircase type signal? The signal is constant between the instant moments of discrete time. We have a staircase signal. And therefore, under this integral sign, this is a constant, providing that we're staying within one time step. In this case, this expression becomes much more useful because this is state transition matrix, but this part of the expression is integral of the state transition matrix, so it is based on state transition matrix. And I will tell you that we can treat this expression as the state variable description of a discrete time system, because this is xk plus 1, this is matrix A. Matrix A is the state transition matrix for time equal to delta t to discrete time interval. And matrix B now is equal to this integral times matrix B of the continuous time system. There is no changes with matrix C. Matrix C is exactly the same as it was in the continuous time system. And now we can, I just said it, matrix A is equal to the state transition matrix for time equal to the time step of the procedure, and matrix B is equal to this integral times matrix B of the continuous system. Matrix C is the same. And we can represent a state transition matrix, and we know how to represent state transition matrix by a series. State transition matrix is equal to unity plus matrix A of the continuous time system times time step plus matrix A of the continuous time system times t squared divided by 2 factorial plus and so on. The integral could be also defined by series. We know how to integrate the series from time equals 0 to time equal capital T. This is what we get. Just don't forget to insert matrix B continuous. So this is the basis for very convenient representation of a discrete time state variable description. Extracted or defined on the basis of the continuous time state variable description. We have continuous time this system description, we have the time step, we can always get the discrete time description represented by this series. And of course, engineers are not wasting time for performing this type of operations. What engineers do, they use computer tools. Computer tool can easily use 20 terms of the series, and the results will be excellent. However, I want to show you a primitive, not so accurate way, but it gives you some feeling for what actually we do when we convert from continuous time to discrete time state variable description. Look, this is the state equation for the continuous time state variable description. What I do, I represent the derivative of state vector by this finite difference. And if I did this, I can proceed and get x t plus 1 time step. It is equal to this expression. And if I would continue this expression, I will get that x of t plus 1 time step is equal to unit matrix plus a time interval times a continuous times x of t. You know, these are first two terms of the series representation of matrix A for the discrete time system. And this is the first term of the series representation of matrix B for the discrete time system. So you can always use this approximation, providing that you're not concerned about accuracy and providing the time step is very small. Now, you should be prepared at this point to have arbitrary form of state variable description, and you should know how to convert this arbitrary form to CCF, to diagonalized form, and the rules of engagement for performing these tasks are exactly the same as the ones considered in the continuous time part of the course. When you have the state variable description of the system, regardless of the specific form of the system, you should be able to go back to the transfer function, of course. In the case of CCF, this task could be performed by inspection, because if you know how to convert transfer function into state variable form, CCF form, you should know the way back by inspection. However, for an arbitrary form, let's consider how this could be done. Let's say that I have xk plus 1 equal to a times xk plus b times uk, y of k is equal to cx of k. Let's start from taking z transform of this expression. So I'm honestly taking z transform of the first expression. I utilize the advanced theorem. This is why I'm getting z in front of x of z. Output equation is written right here. I'm doing some algebra on the state equation of the system. And eventually I'm getting this result. X of z is equal to zi minus a in the power of minus 1 times b times u of z. The next what I can do, I can pre-multiply this expression by matrix C, and then I will get y of z. So if I have y of z, and if we're dealing with the scalars, single input, single output, you will have y of z divided by u of z is equal to the transfer function, z domain transfer function of the system, and it's defined in matrix form as matrix C times zi minus a in the power of minus 1 times matrix B. You know, you probably would have to perform this matrix operation more than once. Use a software tool to do this. And when you use software tool, do not forget to attempt to simplify the result. Otherwise, you will have to deal with numerical noise. What I have here is state variable description of the system that I obtained earlier by inspection, by the way. Matrix A, matrix B, and matrix C. I'm using my computer tool, program CC, to define matrix A, matrix B, and matrix C. Then I compute transfer function G equal to C times IS minus a in the power of minus 1 times b, and I'm getting exactly the result that we were supposed to obtain. I'm getting the original transfer function of the system. And now I want to talk to you about discrete time state variable description of a control system. In this case, I have state equation for the controlled plant, single input, single output, I'm assuming, the output equation, and then I have equation for state variable controller. The state variable controller is a very interesting expression. I normally would have matrix W, which is filter in the reference channel, and you can see it's a static filter. And then I have minus matrix F of the controller times state vector of the controller. Minus Fx is known as the state variable feedback. State variable feedback. You know, this filter W takes very good care of the static properties of the system. However, in some cases, you have to address system overshoot, and therefore, what you probably would prefer to do is to assume that W is equal to unit matrix, and you have to place a specially designed filter H of Z in the reference channel. So the system supposed to have this configuration. Look. What you have is state vector x. To get state vector x, I have signal u times b plus x times a, or matrix A times x. When I will add this term and this term, I'm getting x in k plus 1. If I delay it by one step, I'm getting x, so the state vector. This is matrix C, through which I'm getting output y. This is matrix F, responsible for state variable feedback. Right here, I have minus fx, the state variable feedback. Now, technically, I could have placed here matrix W, the filter. But this filter can address issues of statics, but the system may still have an acceptable overshoot. To avoid this condition, I would replace W by dynamic filter H of Z that I would place right here. Right here. And this is basically what I told you. Look, the closed loop system transfer function will be, the closed loop system state variable definition will be the state equation. Xk plus 1 will be equal to A minus BF times Xk. So now the fundamental matrix is A minus BF. And then matrix B would be turn into B times W times reference. So I would say this is matrix B of the system. How to get closed loop system transfer function? Closed loop system transfer function will be C matrix, ZI minus the fundamental matrix of the closed loop system in the power of minus 1. Times matrix B. And now we will be better off assuming that W is equal to 1, and we will just insert filter H of Z instead. This is equation for transfer function for the reference input. Equation for the transfer function for the disturbance input is this one. In both cases, in this case and in this case, I'm assuming that matrix W is equal to unity, and its functions with respect to reference are replaced, are performed by this dynamic filter HFZ. I want you to note that system design results in the change of the fundamental matrix of the control process. Initially, it was A. Now, when we close loop, this fundamental matrix becomes A minus BF matrix. So matrix F should be chosen strategically. We have to obtain certain system dynamics. Filter H of Z, or maybe in some cases we will use W of Z, the filter W, static filter. This filter H of Z affect both static and dynamic properties of the system. So this filter H of Z should be properly designed. And then we get into the system design problem. Define controller matrix F and filter Z to obtain the desired system properties for this particular controlled process.